Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. My name is Jonathan Sobel. I'm a reporter at the New York Times, and I'll be the moderator for today's session. I'd like to welcome to our club two eminent legal scholars, Professor Yasuo Hasebe and Professor Setsu Kobayashi. Professor Hasebe is from Waseda University. Professor Kobayashi is from Keio University. As we all know, the Abe administration has reinterpreted Japan's constitution. It's changed its view of what the constitution means for Japan's armed forces and how they can act and operate. For decades, successive Japanese governments have interpreted Article 9 of the constitution, which renounces war, to mean that Japan can only fight if it is directly attacked. Now the Abe administration says, no, that's not true. In fact, under Article 9, as it exists, Japan can send its military overseas in certain circumstances to fight alongside allies like the United States. At the same time, the Abe administration has not given up on another goal, which is to rewrite the Constitution itself, to change Article 9 and other parts of it. It was in that context that our two guests were invited to address a committee in Parliament about the Constitution on June the 6th. The result of their testimony for the government was what public relations experts call a failure of messaging. They and one other scholar who was invited were asked what they thought of the Abe administration's efforts to reinterpret the Constitution. They, all three of them, said they thought the government's actions were unconstitutional, that collective self-defense was not compatible with Article 9 of the Constitution as it stands. This has thrown up an obstacle to an already very controversial series of bills that are passing through Parliament right now that would codify how exactly this new interpretation of the Constitution would work in practice. Now, our guests are not what you would call the ideological usual suspects. They are not people that the Abe administration could call ideological enemies. Professor Kobayashi is a longtime advocate of amending the Constitution. Professor Hasebe was invited to the June 4th panel by the LDP itself. I was asking them in the green room earlier what percentage of Japanese constitutional experts they believed were on their side when it came to the legality of collective self-defense. And they estimated that maybe 97-98% of Japanese constitutional scholars believe that collective self-defense is not compatible with Article 9 of the Constitution. A group of 218 eminent scholars has written a letter to that effect to the government. Now, we will first hear from both of our guests, and then we'll, as usual, have time for Q&A. I'm looking forward to a lively discussion and an interesting explanation of how they came to their views and what they think it means for the future of the Abe administration's agenda. Thank you very much. I'll turn over the mic now.
Thank you, Mr. Sobel. Everyone knows that Japanese will start its speech with some apology. So I would also like to apologize for the fact that my English may surely sound like Japanese. But first, I'd like to summarize the memorandum I distributed, which is a part of the paper I contributed to the online journal Constitution Building, a Global Review, 2014, which is soon to appear. I pointed out in the memorandum that the recent change of the official view on Article 9, which has allowed the government to use the right of collective self-defense, has caused a lot of concerns. The main point states from the bottom of page 2. Point 1. The denial of the right of collective self-defense under the current constitution was a conclusion perfected through elaborate deliberations of many years by various government departments. It has been steadily confirmed and repeated. If such a product of many minds of requisite art can be changed in accordance with policy preference of a transitory premier who happens to be in charge, the role of the Constitution to limit political power would almost evaporate. Any interpretation of any constitutional clause seems now up for grabs. Point two, authority of the Cabinet Legislation Bureau has become seriously undermined in the eyes of many people because of this change of interpretation. Even several former chiefs of the Bureau openly criticized this turnaround. The Bureau has been highly regarded because it has given legal advices to various governments from the standpoint detached from party politics. However, on this issue, the current Bureau chief, Mr. Yusuke Yokobatake, is suspected to succumb to Mr. Abe's pressures. If the Bureau has come to say that some government action is constitutional because the Prime Minister wants it to be, there remains scarce respect for its opinions. Point three, it is difficult to understand the exact meaning of the newly issued conditions of use of force. On this text, the Cabinet statement of last July states that use of force is permitted when Japanese people's rights to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness are jeopardized profoundly because of military attacks against foreign countries. If understood literally, it is quite hard to imagine concrete cases where such a situation is realized. While some politicians, including Shinzo Abe, claim that under the new interpretation, self-defense forces could be dispatched to the Hormuz Strait in the Persian Gulf when it is blockaded, since such a blockade would result in the sharp rise of oil prices and make daily lives of the people difficult. Other politicians of the governmental coalition, in particular those of Kome Party, have asserted that it is hardly imaginable that troubles caused by higher oil prices could satisfy the condition. As a result of this change of interpretation, the meaning of Article 9 has become much more blurred, though the normal role of interpretation should have been that of providing determinate meaning to an ambiguous text. Second, I'd like to say a little about the Sunakawa case. Since politicians of the Liberal Democratic Party, including Prime Minister Abe and Vice Party Chairman Komura, assert that this 1959 Supreme Court decision states that use of the right of collective self-defense is constitutional under Article 9. My answer is that this is an erroneous understanding of the Sunakawa judgment. Almost all constitutional law scholars in Japan would support me on this point, I think. In the Sunakawa case, the constitutionality of the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty was disputed. And this treaty determines how the combination of Japan's right of individual self-defense and America's right of collective self-defense should secure the protection of Japan. Japan's right of collective self-defense was not an issue at all in this case. The significance of a precedent should be always evaluated in view of what issue the court gave the judgment. It seems that politicians of the Liberal Democratic Party lack this basic knowledge of law. Anyway, their interpretation is utterly implausible. Third, I'd like to add some points on a policy issue, that is whether the proposed bills would really promote the security of Japan. I seriously doubt it.
if the security of Japan has recently become seriously undermined, as the government purported to insinuate, then it would be quite foolish to send out and disperse our limited defensive resources to all over the globe in order to provide fuel to foreign military forces. Some people have expressed the wishful thinking that if Japan helps American forces all over the world, then surely the US would more earnestly protect Japan. I think this is just a wishful thinking. Every country uses its military forces for its own interests. Besides, in order to initiate a full-scale war, the US government must secure the approval of Congress. The US Constitution says so in the so-called Declare War Clause, Article 1, Section 8, Clause 11. And the US-Japan Security Treaty, Article 5, stipulates each party performs its duties in accordance with its own constitution. So there's no guarantee that Congress approves such military deployment when Japan becomes embroiled in a perilous situation. Though the government asserts that this change of interpretation increases deterrent effects of the US-Japan alliance, this may also bring about military expansion on the part of neighboring countries, making all parties more liable to miscalculate. The risk that Japan might be implicated in quarrels of other countries would also increase. Finally, I'd like to make some comments on the discussion which took place at the Committee on the Constitution of the lower house last Thursday. At the committee discussion, several MPs who belong to the government coalition parties alleged that I misunderstood the official view of the government on the question of the fusion or entanglement of the activities of the self-defense forces and the use of force by foreign military forces. I will not talk about the contents of the official view here because it is too complicated. But I swear that I did not make any misunderstanding. They mistook what I said. The interesting point is that one of the MPs alleged that I made a mistake because I lacked expertise on the questions of national security. You may know that many politicians belonging to the governmental parties have made the similar pejorative allegation that constitutional law scholars in general lack expertise on national security. This allegation is interesting because a couple of years ago, I was invited by the Liberal Democratic Party itself to a committee of the lower house which deliberated on the notorious Specific Official Secret Act to offer my opinions as well as answer questions as an expert. I was one of only two experts who supported the bill, and this act, a Specific Official Secret Act, is an essential element of Japan's national security. Or did they invite an inexpert on national security to make contribution to the deliberations on the act? If so, the current majority and the government should immediately abolish this act, because this act was produced from a seriously defective deliberation process. An inexpert on national security gave his opinion that this act should be enacted. You now see the point. If I say what is congruent with the interests of the government, they say I am an expert. And if I say something which is against the interest of the government, they allege that I am an inexpert. This is quite astounding. That's it from me. Thank you very much for your patience.
Well, I'm not a typical Japanese, so I would like to skip my turn of apology on language difficulty. Of course, I still have language difficulty because I'm a native Japanese. I would like to read my draft. Chapter 1 is titled A Maze of the Article 9 of Japanese Constitution. Needless to say, the Constitution of Japan is the supreme law in Japan, but an ordinary adult could not explain about Article 9 of JC. Section 1 of Article 9 forever renounce war as means of settling international disputes, that is, as means of invasion. So, we can say that we reserve the right to self-defense. Section 2 prescribes that land, sea, and air forces will never maintain, and the right of belligerence will not be recognized. Moreover, Section 2 of Article 76 prescribes that no extraordinary tribunal, such as court-martial, shall be established. So, self-defense forces were established not as military forces, but as the second police in a legal sense. Military forces are, generally speaking, military forces could and should perform the utmost effort to win the battle. However, the police can use necessary and minimum power to subdue the opponent. Second chapter, well-established national policy, not sending SDF abroad. Therefore, the Japanese government has established a firm precedent that we would never send armed forces abroad, that we would never participate with military activities abroad, and so that we could never exercise the right to collective self-defense because that kind of military activities would exceed the necessary and minimum execution of power to defend our country. Chapter 3, my judgment on the new security bill, unwise. However, Abe administration is planning removing the ban on sending SDF abroad. The essence of their reasoning is as follows. Because of the drastic change of international peace and order, that is China's imperialism and North Korea's aggression, the meaning of the necessary and minimum military activities has changed. And cooperation with the allied forces abroad is essentially necessary. In my opinion, this new policy is legally, politically, and economically unwise. First, this is unconstitutional, as mentioned above. If Abe administration would force this policy without amending the Constitution, that would be the beginning of tyranny. That is a destruction of the rule of law. Second, if we would send SDF to support US, we would automatically become a new enemy of Muslim and a target of terrorism. Japan is not a Christian country, but a country of Shinto and Buddhism. We should keep the neutral position. Third, if we would keep company with US at many battlefields abroad, Japan would surely bankruptcy. In conclusion, Japan should concentrate her power to defend herself within her territory and its surrounding. This is constitutional, reasonable, and economical. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll open the floor to questions. As usual, please identify yourselves and keep your questions short and questiony. I'll do it in the order that I see them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That'll be the first group. David, yeah.
Thanks very much, David McNeil for The Economist. The Abe government seems very reluctant to give any specific examples of where this new interpretation of the Constitution might actually be carried out. You know, what scenario are we talking about? Are we talking about an invasion by China, for example? Are we talking about some kind of conflagration on the Korean Peninsula that might involve Japanese troops? I wonder if you have any thoughts on why they're so reluctant to give a specific example of where, of a scenario where this might take place, and if you could elaborate on what you think a likely scenario might be. And the other question I wanted to ask you was about the influence of Nippon Kaigi. We heard that three of the scholars who support the Abe government are members of Nippon Kaigi. Is this organization a significant factor in pushing this legislation or pushing this interpretation of legislation? Thank you.
Thanks, David. And I'm going to introduce our interpreter, Takamatsu-san, before
それに対してエコノミスト氏でございます。今の政府がこの件についてなかなかその新しい憲法解釈のもとでその集団自衛権を行使するため の, その具体的な例シナリオをなかなか出さないわけでございます。何を考えていらっしゃるんでしょうか。例えばその中国が実際に侵略するとか、あるいは朝鮮半島で何か対立があって日本の軍もそれに巻き込まれるか、まあ、いろんなシナリオが考えられるんでございますが、なかなかその具体的なその例というのを出してくださらないんでございます。なぜ出してくれないと思いますでしょうか。そして考えられるようなシナリオというのは何かありますでしょうか。そしてちょっと別の質問でございますが、日本会議でございますでしょうか、という組織がありますが、今この新しいその憲法解釈を支持する3人の著名の学者がいらっしゃるんですけど、みんなこの会議に属しているわけでございます。この日本会議の存在のその意味、その力、その影響力をどう見ていらっしゃいますでしょうか。
最初の質問について私の方から、私自身は具体的な例は簡単には思いつきません。政府の側が果たして具体的な例を想定しているかどうかも私には分かりません。例えばその先ほどお話したホルムズ海峡の件ですが、ご存知の通り今イランとアメリカとは、友好的な関係に向かいつつありまして、ホルムズ海峡がブロケードされるということも具体的には想定しにくいと思います。むしろ政府の側は集団的自衛権が行使されることの方が目的、それ自体が目的なのではないかと私は考えております。
I'd like to answer the first part of your question. In regard to specific concrete examples of when this new interpretation of the Constitution might actually be used, I cannot think of any specific examples. And whether the government does have specific scenarios in mind, I really cannot answer on behalf of the government. Of course, one example that was discussed was the possible blockade of the Strait of Hormuz. But as you know, Iran and the United States are now moving toward a better relationship. As a result, it is very difficult to imagine that such a blockade of the strait might actually take place. It is my belief or my understanding that it is not so much that the government has specific examples or scenarios in mind, but rather it is seeking to somehow gain the acceptance of the right to exercise collective defense. That is the fundamental goal of the government.
The 日本会議は私はたくさん司令がいるので私が答えることになるのですが、日本会議の人々に共通する思いは、第二次世界大戦で負けたことが受け入れがたい、だからその前の日本に戻したい。彼らの憲法改正もそうですし、明治憲法と同じですし、それから今回もそうですね。つまり明治憲法下の世界の軍事5つの大国の一つになって、アメリカとともに世界に進軍したいというようなですね、そういう思いを共有する人々が集まっていて、かつそれは自民党の中に広く根を張っていて、かつよく見ると明治憲法下でエスタブリッシュメントだった人々の子孫が多いと思います。そうするとメイクセンスでしょ。
Nihon Kaigi, which the interpreter is not quite sure if it's Japan Council or Japan Conference.Conference, thank you very much. Japan Conference is an organization that I am fairly familiar with, so I would like to describe this. It's basically an organization of people who share a common belief, and that fundamental belief, I believe, is that they have trouble accepting the fact that the reality that Japan lost World War II. In other words, they want to envision a return of Japan to the status that Japan had before the war began. In other words, their ideas of trying to revise the constitution is to try to create the constitution that is similar to the pre-war constitution, which is referred to as the Meiji constitution. In other words, they would like to again stand tall with the major powers of the world. At that time, there were five major powers of the world. In other words, Japan would like to stand on equal ground with the United States and become an important presence in the world. I think it is these fundamental beliefs that are shared by many, many people in the Japan Conference. I would also like to note that the Japan Conference has very deep and wide roots within the LDP. In other words, there are many LDP members who are closely associated or who support the ideas of the Japan Conference. If I may go even further, I would also say that, as I mentioned, many of the people who support the ideals of the Japan Conference envision the Japan before the war and have very good thoughts about how Japan was before the war. In other words, during the time of the Meiji era, there were many great politicians and powerful people. And it seems to me that many of the people who are active in the Japan Conference are the descendants of many people who were very prominent, who were part of the establishment during the Meiji period.
Five major military powers.
Excuse me. And when I said earlier that Japan wants to stand tall with the five major powers in the pre-war era, I meant the five major military powers before the war.
All right, I need to see the same hands again, Michael, and then we'll go over here. First, Michael. Michael Penn of the Shingetsu News Agency. I want to talk a little bit about the reaction of the Liberal Democratic Party to your testimony. Two particular reactions which got my attention. I want your reaction to them. First, from Akiko Santo, one of the heads of one of the factions, said that somebody should be punished for selecting Mr. Hasebe to be to testify in the Diet. What does this tell you about the way that expertise is used in the Diet and the appreciation they have for scholarship? And the second comment came this weekend, I believe, from Mr. Komura, the vice president of the LDP, who said that if the government follows the advice of scholars, then Japan will have no peace and no security. It will basically destroy the nation. So, would following the advice of scholars destroy Japan?
はい、新月ニュースエージェンシーでございます。私は2つの質問がございます。2つとも先生方たちが 国会で証言した時のその後の自民党内部でのその反応についてでございます。最初の質問でございますが、三戸明子先生でございますでしょうか。派閥の一つのトップを務めている方でございますが、長谷部先生が証言されるということを、それを決めた方は処罰されるべきだというような発言をされました。この発言を聞きまして、先生はどうお感じになりますでしょうか。そのいわゆる専門知識を有している学者をどうこういう政治家は見ていると思いますでしょうか。で、二つ目の質問でございますが、これは高村さんでございます、副総裁でございますでしょうか、自民党の。彼が発言したことなんでございますが、学者は学者もいろんな意見を持ってもいいかもしれませんけど、学者の意見を政治家、政府が追ってそれを認めるということになりますと、国の平和とその安全保障は確保することができない、国が滅びると言ってましたが、どう思いますでしょうか。
ありがとうございます。まず最初の質問についてですが、私が証言をした日の憲法審査会のメインテーマはコンスティテューショナリズムでした。で、コンスティテューショナリズムの専門家ということで事務局が私を選んだと。で、それを自民党が受け入れたというふうに私は伺っております。で、ですから私はコンスティテューショナリズムの専門家として呼ばれたと、ので、ありますけれども、その人間がたまたま、九条について発言をしたのがけしからんと、というのが、三藤さんの、発言の趣旨なのだろうと思いますが、しかし質問があれば私は自分の思っていることを答えるだけだと思います。
In regard to your first question, I was asked to speak, as you know, in front of the committee in charge of the Constitutional Research Committee. And since the main theme of that committee meeting was to be constitutionality, I was approached by the secretary.
Constitutionalism.
And as an expert in this field, I was approached by the secretariat of the committee. My understanding was that my name was presented to the people in charge at the LDP, and the LDP people approved of my presence there. That was my understanding. So I came and I was asked many questions about constitutionalism, about the Constitution, and I responded. But of the different questions that were given to me, I happened to respond to one question by talking about Article 9. And this apparently was something that was very unpleasant for Ms. Santo, and that's why she gave the comments that she apparently gave. But my position is that if I'm asked a question, I answer honestly what is on my mind.
それから2番目の問題ですけれども、先ほど私がスピーチの中で申し上げました通り、私は今回の安全保障法案は日本の安全をむしろ危うくすると考えております。日本の安全を確実に守りたいのであればぜひ学者の意見を聞くべきであるというふうに私は思います。
And in regard to your second question, as I said in my opening speech, in regard to the security legislation that is being discussed today, I do not believe that the security legislation will actually help secure the security of Japan. In other words, in fact, I would go as far as to say that I fear that it might have the opposite effect, that it would actually make Japan, put Japan in a more dangerous position than at present. So I believe very strongly that if Japan truly wants to have a more secure situation, and if politicians and government want to secure the security of Japan, they should listen very carefully to the opinions of scholars.
Thank you.
Isabel Reynolds from Bloomberg. I'd like to ask your opinion about the U.S.-Japan defense guidelines. It almost seems as though through those guidelines, Japan has promised to do things that it would later back up with the new defense laws. Do you think that by doing that in advance of passing the laws, it will damage relations with America? By effectively promising things in the defense guidelines that it may not be able to deliver, is there a chance that ties with America could be damaged.
ブルームバーグ氏でございます。日米防衛ガイドラインについてお伺いしたいと思いございます。もうすでにこのガイドラインを通しまして日本はいろんな約束をアメリカにしたわけでございます。でそれを実現するためにその約束を果たすために、今このような安保法制が議論されているわけでございます。いかがでございますでしょうか。その安保法制がまだその整備されていない中でいろんなことを約束そのガイドラインを通しまして米国に約束してしまったということでございますので、もう万が一それがうまくいかなかったということなどを考えますと、日米関係が悪化するというようなことも考えられますでしょうか。
では私の方からまずよろしいですか。どうもありがとうございます。ガイドラインでまずできるかできないかもうわからないことを先に約束してしまうというのは大変リスキーな選択であったと私は考えております。
I'd like to first of all say thank you very much for your question. And in regard to the guidelines, to make promises in advance when you are not sure if you will actually be able to fulfill those promises or not, I think is a very risky thing to do. It was a risky choice to make those promises.
そして最近のガイドラインの内容はむしろ元々の日米安保条約の枠をはみ出しているのではないかというそういう批判も非常に強くあります。
I would also like to point out that in regard to the recent contents of the new guidelines, the recently revised guidelines, there have been some severe criticism that these new guidelines go beyond the scope of the original U.S.-Japan treaty, security treaty.
従いまして、これがうまく、この安保法制が成立しなければ、日米間の関係が悪化することはあるかもしれませんが、それはもともと無理な約束をしたことにその原因があるというふうに私は考えます。
And so in response to your question, yes, if it turns out that the security legislation is for some reason not passed, and it turns out that the promises that were made by Japan to the United States are not able to be fulfilled, then yes, there is a possibility that the relationship between the United States and Japan could worsen. But I would say that the reason for that is that because Japan went ahead and made promises at a time when it could not be sure that it could keep those promises.
Professor Kobayashi, go ahead. Yes, I think that the relationship between the United States and Japan will not be bad. That is, the Japanese and American officials頭がいいですから、ガイドラインが法的拘束力ないこと知ってますからね。勝手に夢を語り合って、そのガイドラインの上に法律があって、法律の上に条約があって、条約の上に憲法があるわけですから、やっぱダメだったって済むんじゃないんですか。
I personally don't think that even if that situation came to pass, that the relationship between U.S. and Japan would worsen. The reason for that is that I believe that the bureaucrats, people who work for the government in both the United States and Japan, are very, very smart, very, very clever. And they knew from the very beginning that those guidelines, the promises that were made and the guidelines really had no binding effect. In other words, it was simply a group of statements that were made on the basis of idealistic dreams. In other words, all the bureaucrats understand that there are guidelines, but on top of them, the things that have more power are laws, and the things that have more power than laws are treaties, and things that have more power than treaties are the Constitution. So that in the end result, if these promises are not able to be kept, the bureaucrats will shrug and say, well, we tried.
Thank you.
Linda Sieg with Reuters. Of course, it's too early to tell, but it does seem quite possible that the government will go ahead and use its majority in parliament to enact this legislation, regardless of concerns about its constitutionality. In that case, what legal recourse do you foresee? The government keeps saying it's up to the Supreme Court. And could we see a situation in which there is some sort of suit which does eventually go to the Supreme Court, but in the meantime, this becomes a fait accompli, and we have seen in the past that the Supreme Court can be very reluctant to challenge that sort of fait accompli, or perhaps even say, well, it's unconstitutional, but it's not invalid. So, thank you.
ロイターズでございます。まだちょっと結論を出すのには早いと思うんでございますが、やはりその、数、を使ってそのこの、安保法制を、強行、 成立採決するさせるかもしれないというふうに考えられます。どんなにその意見かもしれないというその意見が出されたとしましても、そういう心配があったとしましても、それを強行採決するかもしれません。もしそれがそうなった場合には、どのような法的手段でそれに対抗できると思いますでしょうか。今までは政府はその最高裁の判決を追って盾にしているわけでございますが、実際にそれをそのチャレンジするため の、 その例えばその訴訟というのが可能になりますでしょうか。で、実際にその訴訟がその起きたとしても、実際にその一応採決されたものは採決されていると生きているものになってしまうのでございますので、その実際にその最終的な判決が出るまでの状況はどうなるの間はどうなるんでしょうか。そしてまた最高裁という話になるんでございますが、またその訴訟が起こされたとしましても、今までのその最高裁の判決を見ますと、もう実際にいろんな問題があったとしましても、ある現実がある場合は違憲であっても、違憲状態っていうところっていう判決を出されたとしましても、無効っていうことはなかなか言ってくれない、そういう判決を出してくれないのが最高裁だと思いますので、そういう意味でその実際に訴訟が起こされたとしましても、何か変わると思いますでしょうか。どうなると思いますでしょうか。
まず私の方から、最近最高裁は変化をしつつありますので、今までと違った態度を取る可能性はあると私は思っています。
First of all, I'd like to remark by saying that although the Supreme Court has acted as you have said in the past, in recent times, I think the Supreme Court itself is beginning to change.
ただ他方、裁判所に頼りすぎるのも良くない。
But on the other hand, I think it is wrong to simply over depend too much on the judiciary system or on the courts alone.
まず次の国政選挙で、新しい政府を成立させて、一旦成立した、これらの 法律をやはり撤回する、元に戻す、ということを考えるべきだと思います。
In other words, I think what is necessary is for the people to take a stand in the next general election, national elections, and elect a new government, and ensure that this new government basically undoes the legislation that was passed during the previous administration. In other words, to bring things back to their original state, their current state.
弁護団の一員として訴訟の準備をしています。それは法律が有効になった瞬間から、今まで日本になかった戦争の危険、海外で戦争する危険が具体化するんですね。だから平和に生きる権利というのが憲法の前文と9条で保障されているならば、それが今は海外派兵できないから守られてるんですけど、法律ができた瞬間からそれを侵されたという理解をして、国民誰でもですね、集団で政府に対して違憲行為でここ、平和が傷つけられたという訴訟を今準備しています。ただかなり技術的には難しい。でその次の段階は、実際に具体的に海外派兵の命令が下った時、その部隊の一員がそこから逃げ出して懲戒処分を受けて、それが違憲無効だと訴える。で一番悲劇的なのは、実際に海外派兵に行って死んだ人がいた場合、その遺族が違憲な戦争で家族が殺されたと訴える。この準備を我々はすでに始めております。
Actually, I am already a member of a team of lawyers who are planning to file a lawsuit in the event that this legislation is passed. In fact, in the moment that this legislation is passed, the moment that this law comes into effect, it means that Japan will suddenly face a different situation from now, which means that for the first time in the post-war years, Japan will actually face the possibility, the real possibility, the concrete possibility of being embroiled in a war, and we believe that that goes against the Constitution in the preamble in Article 9. The right of people to live safely is a right that is guaranteed. And now with the possibility, if this legislation is passed, with the possibility that self-defense forces, Japanese troops, might be able to be sent abroad, that guarantee of the right to live safely can be considered to be violated. Therefore, when the security legislation is passed, all people in Japan will have the right to sue the government for taking unconstitutional measures that puts themselves in danger. There are many technical aspects to this lawsuit that we are in the planning stages of, and I would like to give you a couple of examples of the next steps that we will take. First of all, if the order for troops to be deployed abroad comes in and a person is one of the self-defense forces decides that he does not want to participate and decides therefore to basically desert his troops, then he would of course probably be court-martialed or punished in some way. But again, we could counter that by saying that the original order that was given for him to be sent abroad was against the Constitution. And therefore his court-martial would be invalid. I'm sorry, it would not be a court-martial. It would be just simply a regular court he would be prosecuted in regular court for having deserted his troops. But we could say that because that original order was based on an unconstitutional legislation, that his punishment would be invalid. The second further step would be that, and it's unfortunate to even think about, but if as a result of troops being deployed abroad, if someone were killed abroad, then his family could again sue the government for saying that a family member was killed because of this unconstitutional act.
Tyler, you've been waiting a while, Jimbo-san.
Terry Jimbo, the video news. ビデオニュースのジンボです。日本語で質問します。当協会のこの記者会見を主催している委員会の共同委員長を務めています。先生方にお伺いしたいんですけど、今のお話に関連します。それからあと、高村副総裁がですね、憲法を解釈するのは憲法学者ではない、私たち政治家だというような発言もされていることに関してですね、日本ではその憲法に違反すると思われるような法律ができたときに、先ほど小林先生が言ったみたいに、実際に法律が適用されて誰かがそれを違反を犯し、その違反行為の訴訟の中でそもそも憲法が違憲なのだから、この違反による、訴追は無効であるというような形を取らないと、違憲であるということがですね、争えないというのは意外と、多くの人が知らない、日本には憲法裁判所というものが、スペシフィックなものがなくて、最高裁がその一部をやってるわけですけど、でしかもこのような、安保に関わるものに関しては、行為統治論、投資行為論ですかというような判断で、裁判所が介入すべきところではないというような判断もこれまでしてきている。そうするとこの問題は一体、小室さんは我々政治家だって言ってるんだけど、一体本当に日本では誰が違憲かどうかということを、本来決める立場にいるのかというのが1点目。同時に、なぜ日本ではその憲法、明らかな憲法違反に対してですね、そのような違反行為があって誰かが実際に訴追されないとですね、その憲法が違反であるということができないような仕組みの、それはそう意図されているのか、それともある種の欠陥なのか、そこをお願いいたします。
I'm from Video News, and I'd like to ask some questions that are related to what Mr. Komura, the Vice President of the LDP, said. One of the statements that he made was that interpretation of the Constitution should not be left to academics, to constitutional experts, but actually to us politicians. We are the ones that should take bear responsibility and should make those decisions. Japan, even though a law is sometimes passed where there is a question and some debate about the constitutionality of that law, the way the system works in Japan, and I think most Japanese people are not aware of the system, is that the way it works is that the law is passed. And once a law is passed and someone eventually does something that goes against the law, or basically what happens is that a lawsuit needs to be filed in the courts that points to the unconstitutionality of the law, and then it goes through the system and eventually a final decision is made. It would seem on the surface, in other words, that when that original law is passed, if there is some debate about the constitutionality, that should be worked out before the law is originally passed. But in Japan, we do not have, as in some other countries, a constitutional court, a court that is focused on matters relating simply to the Constitution. The Supreme Court in Japan takes up some of the activities that a constitutional court would in other countries, but it doesn't take everything up. In other words, there are things that should need to do, especially when it comes to matters regarding national security. For example, this idea of an act. The act of the state and other constitutional matters. These are things that are not decided unless a court case has been brought to the regular system. So a regular court system. So I have basically two questions. First of all, if Mr. Komura says it shouldn't be academics that decide constitutionality and it should be politicians, and some other people disagree with that, in your opinion, who should really actually make this decision about the constitutionality of certain matters? And secondly, in Japan, as I've mentioned, there is this extraordinary system where matters of constitutional matters that have to deal with constitutionality are not taken up by a constitutional court, but someone actually has to file a lawsuit. It has to be battled through the court system before a final verdict is made about the constitutionality of something. Why is the system in place? Was it a deliberately created system, or was it simply the result of the unfortunate result of different actions?
最初の質問についてですが、日本においては内閣法制局がこの種の問題について、違憲合憲の判断をまず下して、で従来は一貫して内閣法制局は集団的自衛権の行使は違憲であると言い続けていました。何度も何度もそう言ってきました。したがって、そういった法律は、提案されることはなかった。ところが今の内閣の下で内閣法制局はプレッシャーに負けて解釈を変えた。そこに問題があるということになります。
First of all, in regard to your first question about when a piece of legislation is being discussed and there is some question about the constitutionality, it has always been the Cabinet Legislation Bureau that has taken the responsibility of determining whether something is considered unconstitutional in violation of the Constitution or whether it follows the tenets of the Constitution. And in regard to this kind of security legislation matters, in regard specifically to the right to exercise the right to collective self-defense, the Cabinet Legislation Bureau for all successive bureaus have taken the consistent position that the right to exercise collective defense is against the Constitution, in violation of the Constitution. Therefore, any security legislation that proposed or assumed that Japan had such collective defense rights was never actually proposed or deliberated in the Constitution. What has changed is that the Cabinet Legislation Bureau, the current Cabinet Legislation Bureau, has unfortunately, as I mentioned in my speech, succumbed to political pressure, and they have changed their official interpretation of the Constitution in regard to this matter.
2番目 の, ご質問についてですけれども、日本はアメリカと同じシステムを、取っております。
In regard to your second question, Japan is taking the same sort of judicial system as the United States.
したがって、その裁判の解決にとって必要な限りでしか裁判所は、法令の違憲性、合憲性については判断を下しません。
In other words, the courts do not vote, voice an opinion about the constitutionality of a matter unless it has been presented as a case before the courts.
ドイツでは憲法裁判所というのがありますが、ただドイツの憲法裁判所も扱う事件の圧倒的多数はやはり事後的な、実際に事件が起こった後で、その前提として、法令の合憲性について判断を下す、そういうケースでございます。
And as you have pointed out, some nations, for example, Germany, do have constitutional courts. But even if we look at the German constitutional court, the majority of the cases, the majority of the verdicts that they hand out are in regard to cases where action has already taken place. And then they go back and basically look at past precedents and then vote on the constitutionality of an event. In other words, they do not give an advance, they do not voice an opinion before legislation is passed or anything like that. They go through the regular court system.
コブラ副総裁が勝手に引用している判決が実は全てを言っておりまして、戦争というのは国の存続に関わる大問題ですから、最高裁判所の15人の裁判官、選挙で選ばれていません。彼らが決めるわけにはいかない。これはアメリカ、フランス、 の洗礼に学んだんですね。それでだからあの判決の中で 一時的にはこれ大事な、一時的には選挙で選ばれた国会と内閣が決める、だけど最終的には主権者国民が決めるって言ってるんですね。だからさっき長谷部教授も言われたように、ああいう狂ってしまった政治は次の選挙で倒せばいいんですよね。
In regard to Mr. Komura's statements, the verdict that he is quoting basically epitomizes everything that is wrong with this issue, or that he goes basically to the heart of the problem. He's basically saying that the security of the nation, the survival of a nation, the ability of a nation and its people to keep on existing into the future lies is a very, very important issue, and war could very much endanger existence of the nation. And something that is so important, it cannot be decided upon by the Supreme Court, because the Supreme Court is made up of 15 people who did not go through elections to get to their current position. And his statement basically follows on the statements, similar statements made by in the United States, France, etc. And certainly, according to the verdict that he quite often quotes from, it is through elections that the people have chosen cabinet and the diet, and therefore they bear the responsibility to ensure the survival of the nation, the safety of the people. But then that goes back to what Professor Hasebe said earlier. Fundamentally, the sovereignty of a nation lies with the people of Japan. And if the people have elected the current cabinet and they have elected the current diet, well, then in the next election, as Professor Hasebe said, they should simply overturn this problematic and this kind of almost crazy, to do a literal translation, current government and administration.
Richard Lloyd Parry of The Times. The debate about collective self-defense is recent and very heated. But I wonder if there isn't a more fundamental question and a fundamental problem, which is the existence of the self-defense forces themselves. I'm not a legal expert, but you don't have to be a legal expert to understand what the Constitution says. It says land, sea, and air potential will never be maintained. Now, I understand the political reasons in the 1950s why there was a reversal on that, but it seems to me that that language is completely unambiguous, with leaving no room for alternative interpretation at all. And all the alternative interpretations that have been put on it have been political and brought in extra constitutional considerations. So shouldn't conscientious constitutional scholars be opposing not only collective self-defense, but the existence of the self-defense forces?
はい、タイムズ、イギリスのタイムズ紙でございます。まあ、最近ではその集団自衛権の行使について、まあ、非常に議論が進んでいるわけでございます。非常にその過熱しているわけでございますが、しかしながらよく考えてみますと、もっと基本的な問題がその裏にあるのではないかと思います。でそれはその自衛隊そのものの、まあ、存在、ということでございます。まあ、私はその、法律の専門家ではありません。しかしながら私でもやっぱりその、憲法を読むことができますので、はっきりその、陸海、空軍側はその保持しないとかって書いてるわけでございます。でこれは非常に明確、誰だって専門家でなくても理解できることでございます。でそう申しましても、やっぱり1950年代 の、 その世界情勢のことを考えますと、それはやっぱりどうしてもそういうものが必要になったっていう、そういう政治的な判断が必要だったっていうのも分からなくもないわけでございます。しかしながらやはりそういういろんな今までの解釈って言いますのは、やはりいろんなその政治的な要素があって、そしてそのいろんな解釈はその新しいそれぞれのその憲法の問題を生んできたわけでございます。ですので最終的には本当に道徳的な、あるいは倫理観を持つその憲法学者、あるいはその学者、法律の学者というのは、やはりその集団自衛権のお話だけではなく、もともと自衛隊そのものを持つことにどうかということを話に出すべきではないでしょうか。声を出すべきではないでしょうか。
古い話になりますけれども、ハミルトンがフェデラリストペーパーで次のような話をしています。
First of all, this is a rather old story, but there was a man named Hamilton who did something in the Federalist Papers.
Federalist Papers. Yes. In that paper, Hamilton discussed about the proposal to insert a clause which prohibits the maintenance of military standing military forces. Insert such a clause to the constitution, newly proposed constitution of the United States. And the Hamilton says this is an very ambiguous clause because for what period these military forces were kept, this become maintenance. He suggested when the danger, national security danger has happened, perhaps military forces can be collected. Prohibition of maintenance doesn't prohibit literally the collection of the military forces. So this is not such a ambiguous clause. And the second point is that the official view is, as you know, that it is manifestly unreasonable for the Constitution to not to secure the security of the people's lives and properties. Therefore, the Article 9 should allow such a range of maintaining minimum forces to protect people's lives and properties. And I think this is within the range of a reasonable reading of the Article 9.
Hey.
You don't need to translate English, not for this audience. It's okay.
自衛隊については2つの根拠をはっきりしていまして、1つは9条は国際紛争を解決する手段としてはと条件がついてまして、これは1928年のパリ不戦条約、戦争放棄条約 の文言と同じで、それ以来この国際法上の普通の標準的な理解としては、これは侵略戦争の放棄で自衛戦争を放棄していないというものですね。これが一つ。もう一つは国際法上の独立主権国家の自然権、ナチュラルライツとして、ライトトゥセルフディフェンスは、自然権である以上は条文の根拠いらないんですよね。だからそういう根拠で自衛隊は存在しているし、それから砂川判決も書かれている。それから終戦直後、日本に自衛隊がなかったのは、日本は危険な国だったから米軍が完全占領して持たせなかったので、そちらの方が政治的事情で、それは不自然ですよ。以上です。
I'd like to add two points about the self-defense forces, and there are two justifications for having the existence of the self-defense forces. First of all, in Article 9, it says, yes, that there would be no use of force, but there is a specific condition placed on that statement, which is that Japan will not have military forces to resolve international conflicts. In other words, and this terminology, this phrase actually comes from a 1928 treaty made in Paris, which was basically the treaty to renounce war. And under international law, the fundamental standard understanding of this statement is that it refers to renunciation of war in terms of wars of invasions, in other words, a war of belligerency. But in international understanding and law, there is no restriction on the right to self-defense. One always has the right to defend one's own nation and people. And secondly, there is
is another concept in international law, which has to do with natural rights. And this natural rights applies also to sovereign, independent nations. It is considered to be a natural right of nations, individual sovereign nations, to be able to defend itself. So the idea of the self-defense forces existing does not go against natural rights. In fact, and this is basically what the Sinagawa verdict refers to, during the immediate post-war years, when there was no self-defense forces, Japan had no military to protect itself. That was an extraordinary situation. That was a situation where the only military forces that existed were the occupation forces. And that actually was an unnatural, extraordinary situation. And the situation where self-defense forces exist, where a country has enough might to be able to protect itself, is the ordinary situation.
インドネシアの新聞記者なんですけれども、リチャール・スシロと申します。ハセベ先生にちょっとお伺いしたいなんですけれども、憲法の専門家の目から見た今の状態なんですけれども、逆に先生から何か、解決のために、せっかく今の反乱やってるから解決するために何が一番必要でしょうか。私からインドネシア人から見たら、これは当たり前ことなんですけれども、国のために、自衛隊のために守るために、こういうことを変えなきゃいけないですね。憲法9条、これは私の考え方、もしインドネシアの国がアタックされたら絶対に死ぬまで戦うですね。これはインドネシア人の考え方だから、日本はちょっと違うかもしれませんので、どういう解決のやり方の、憲法の専門家のから解決、いろいろコンスティテューショナルの言葉がどういう言葉になりますでしょうか。よろしくお願いします。
I have a question for Professor Hasebe. As an Indonesian, and I'm not a constitutional expert, but given the current situation, can you give us a solution? What kind of solution would you offer to the current administration? There are verdicts that have already been decided, but it seems, as an Indonesian, as an outsider, that what is being discussed seems just absolutely makes common sense. I mean, it's natural that a country would have self-defense forces. It's natural. For example, if our own country were attacked, we would fight to the death to protect our country and our people. But given all of these different questions that are existing, what would be your advice to solve this current situation?
Thank you for your question. According to the official government view, which was repeated and persistently maintained, is that Japan has the right of individual self-defense, even under Article 9. Therefore, when Japan is attacked by foreign forces, obviously, Japan can respond to that attack if that response is necessary and minimum. I think what you are concerned about is already resolved by the official interpretation of the Constitution.
Anything to add? Thanks.
で個別的自衛権というのはもう認められているので、今のその ご心配はそれでもう自分で
対応する。
フリーランスのジャーナリスト田中隆作と申します。お二人の教授に、大原則に返った質問をさせていただきます。安倍政権は、今回の、ストレンジでイリーガルでアンコンスティチューショナルな法案を撤回すべきだと思いでしょうか。安倍政権は今回の法案を撤回すべきだと思いでしょうか。であるとすれば、その理由をお聞かせください。国会での証言と重なっても結構ですから、理由をお聞かせください。
So I'm a freelancer. I'd like to ask a very, very fundamental question from goes to principles. Given the fact that the legislation that is being proposed by Prime Minister Abe is strange and illegal and unconstitutional, do you think that he should retract this legislation? In other words, pull from a deliberation. If so, why? And you can repeat some of the things that you actually said in the Diet Subcommittee in response to this question.
Oh, thank you. I think the government should retract these bills because the core element of these bills, the allowing use of the right of collective self-defense, is manifestly unconstitutional. And also, it is quite likely that these bills will bring about our unconstitutional entanglement of the activities of self-defense forces and the use of force of the foreign military forces, perhaps the U.S. military forces. That is my answer.私は撤回すべきだと思います。確信的な部分、つまり集団的自衛権の行使を容認している部分が憲法違反、明らかに憲法違反であり、かつ違憲の他国軍隊の武力行使との自衛隊の活動の一体化、これをもたらす蓋然性が高いからです。撤回すべきだと思います。
私も結論は撤回すべきで、違憲というのはもちろんですが、もう憲法違反というのは先ほど来説明しましたで、恐ろしいのは憲法違反がまかり通ると、要するに憲法に従って政治を行うというルールがなくなって北朝鮮みたいな国になってしまうんですね。あのキムケと安倍家が一緒になっちゃうんで、 これは絶対に阻止しなければいけない。それから安倍さんの言う通りにしたら、日本の自衛隊はアメリカの軍隊の2軍セカンダリーになっちゃって、でその結果日本は傷ついた上に破産してしまいます。だから何一ついいことないんですね。だから撤回すべきで、撤回しないならば選挙で倒すべきだろうと思います。
Speaking conclusions first, I believe, yes, that this legislation should be retracted. Of course, we've already discussed the unconstitutionality of this legislation, and I've talked a little bit about the fundamental ideas behind infringements or violations of the Constitution. And if this kind of unconstitutionality is allowed to sort of pass or is allowed to be accepted, then the fundamental rules that bind politicians, that they must follow the tenets of the Constitution, will eventually become lessened. They will feel less constrained to follow the rules of the Constitution. In that case, Japan could possibly become a country very similar to North Korea. The Kim family could, the Abe family could become something like the Kim family. And if we allow what Prime Minister Abe has apparently envisioned to become a reality, then I believe that eventually the self-defense forces could become the secondary line or the secondary forces of the U.S. military forces. As I've explained earlier, this would create a situation where Japan itself might suffer a tremendous harm and damage, and as I mentioned earlier, it could also suffer economic damage. It could go bankrupt. There's nothing positive for Japan in passing this kind of legislation. So again, going back to this conclusion, I think this legislation bill should be retracted, and if not, then I think the people should stand up and vote and overturn this current administration.
Siegfried Knittel, freelancer from Germany. I never understood the function of the legislation officer. So is this legislation office, this institution, does it, it was, it connect?
Cabinet Registration Bureau.
Yes. So it connects policy and the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. But is this not against the kind of thinking of independent power? Of judicative, executive, and legislative, should be not the court really independent from from the policy. This is not kind of against the rule of law. It's a, in reality, this Cabinet Nation legislative office is a kind of a, means a kind of a rule of politicians, not a rule of law.
ドイツのフリーの問題でございます。あの、内閣法制局、についてあまりちょっとよく理解できてないのかもしれません。あ、これは、まああの、内閣の一部ということでございますが、まあ、私の理解では一応その立法、府と、まあ、あの最高裁判所を、まあ、ある意味でコネクトする、というような、まあ、あの役割を果たしているというふうに、感じているんでございますが、しかしながら本当はその三権分離の原則を考えますと、全く第三者、機関であるべきではないのでしょうか。本当に独立したものではないのでしょうか。つまりその法の統治じゃなくて内閣に入っているということでございますと、政治家の統治の下でその、仕事をしているというような組織になるのではないでしょうか。
Thank you. This Cabinet Legislation Bureau was made on the model of the French Conseil d'État.This gives legal advice, expertise legal advice to the, not only to the cabinet, but to the other government departments too. This bureau was highly respected and regarded because they give their legal opinions independently, detached from party politics. That was the tradition before last July.
あの、日本の意見審査を考えると、入り口で法制局、内閣法制局がやって、出口で最高裁がやる仕組みになっていたのですが、ご指摘のとおり、内閣法制局というのは、単に内閣の一部門、下にある部門に過ぎない。でもなぜそれがコンセイユデタのように力を持ってきたかというと、あの人間の力だったんですね。優秀な人がプライドを持って守ってきたんです。ところが今回人事権を行使されて、コンセイユデタは、あ、失礼、法制局は単に内閣官房についている下の局の一つに、あの形式通りの弱さになってしまった。これすごく歴史的なことだと思います。
I would also like to add an opinion, which is that in regard to the Cabinet Legislation Bureau, originally the system is, as you understand, that for constitutional matters, the debates always began with the Cabinet Legislation Bureau, and the debates always ended with a decision by the Supreme Court. And this system worked for a long time, even in spite of the fact that, as you've pointed out, the Cabinet Legislation Bureau is, in the final analysis, simply one organ, a subordinate organ within the Cabinet office. Why, however, did the Cabinet Legislation Bureau have such authority and was so highly respected? I think it had to do with the fact that the people that were responsible there were of great quality and also were had great pride. They felt they had this, this role of defending the Constitution. However, with the current administration, as you know, the current administration basically used its right to make personnel decisions, and as a result of choosing certain people to head the Cabinet Legislation Bureau, it's basically decreased or diminished.The role and the authority and the standing of this Cabinet Legislation Bureau to all of the other bureaus, the subordinate organizations within the cabinet. I think this change is a historical one.
Thank you. Okay, we've got just under 15 minutes left. There are a number of hands up, including some people that I don't know. So I'm going to keep going with working journalists. As long as you are working journalists, keep your hands up, and we'll get through.As many as we can, and then if there's time left, then we'll hear from some associates. Please go ahead.
AFP 通信社の長谷川です。日本語ですいません。官房長官はというか、まあ、政府の人たちは今回の安保法案は、まあ、合憲だとおっしゃる憲法学者もいっぱいいるということなんですけれども、あの先生方お二方。にしてみると、どれくらい日本でどれくらいの割合の憲法学者の人が違憲だとおっしゃってるんでしょうか。だと、もしその大部分の方が違憲だという見解であるなら、 私たちその法律の専門家でないものからすると、もう裁判所の裁判官も含めてその放送の人たちの間での主流の意見というものがあるんであれば、それが判決に反映されるんじゃないかと思うんですけれども、その辺はどのようにお考えでしょうか。
From AFP, in regard to the Chief Cabinet Secretary statements and in regard to other governmental official statements, the fundamental understanding of the government is that the current security legislation is constitutional and that they have many, many constitutional experts that support this view. As constitutional experts yourself, what percentage of constitutional experts, academics in Japan, do you think that this current legislation is in violation of the Constitution? And if your answer is that the majority thinks so, then I would assume, as non-experts, that this similar view would be shared by other people, most of the people in the judiciary system, including judges, meaning that eventually, if suits are filed, then this overriding view of the unconstitutionality of this current legislation would be reflected in the verdicts that are issued. What do you think about this?
本日の、夜10時からの報道ステーションが、憲法研究者に対するこの問題についてのアンケートの結果を公表することになっています。ですから、そちらを ご覧いただければ正確なところが分かるだろう。で、私の推測はおそらく 95% を超える憲法学者は違憲だというと思います。
Tonight, as you know, there was a television news program called Hodo Station, which starts at 10 o'clock, and they have announced that they have conducted a survey, sent questionnaires to many, many constitutional experts within Japan, and they have finally collected the results, and they're going to announce them this evening at 10 o'clock. So please watch that program and get the final numbers. But my personal opinion is that over 95% of constitutional experts regard this current security legislation being discussed as unconstitutional.
それから裁判官を含めた放送一般の中で、これが違憲である、というふうにお考えの人も非常に多いだろうと思います。弁護士については多分小林先生がよくご存知。裁判官の関係ですと、前の内閣法制局長官です、ミスター常幸山本who was a former chief of the Cabinet Legislation Bureau, who is now a justice of the Supreme Court. He answered to the question when he was nominated to the Supreme Court. It's unconstitutional to send troops to the other side of the globe and have them exercise the use of collective defense, self-defense. Therefore, this is one typical case. And as you know, perhaps.This is my suspect. I suspect that he was required to resign from the chief because he was against that view.
Maybe you can translate. I'm speaking English because you started answering in Japanese.
放送 の弁護士の世界については小林先生お話になるでしょう。それから裁判官に関して言えば、前の内閣法制局長官であった山本恒興氏は、今最高裁の裁判官ですが、就任の最高裁の就任の会見の際に、地球の裏側まで行って武力行使をするのは憲法違反であろうというふうに述べておられました。
いいですか。ごめんなさい、専門家の中でどの程度かというのはもう答えは出てまして、大学の教授の 95% が違憲と言っている以上、それを習った人々ですから弁護士会もそのような状態で今運動をずっと続けて、ただ弁護士会かわいそうだったのは、ずっと1年ぐらい運動していたけども、メディアが問題にしてなかったんですね。ところがこの間の憲法審査会以来ですね、メディアがまた生き返って、メディアが死んでたんですよ。 生き返って弁護士会の活動なども取り上げてくれるようになったので弁護士会も生き返りました。それで僕にはですね、個人的に高いランクの裁判官とか検察官もおっしゃる通りだ、頑張ってくれと連絡が来る。それは当たり前の話で、さっきも言ったように専門家の常識としては当たり前で、それを国民が共有してないことが問題であったんで、それはやはりメディアの責任だと思うんですね。で、今日ここ呼ばれてとても嬉しいんですけども、以上です。
In regard to the opinion of experts on this matter, I think it's very, very clear. Over 95% of professors at universities have this understanding of the Constitution. And when we're talking about people in the judiciary or in the legal field, lawyers, etc., these are former students of these 95% of these university professors. So in the legal profession, I'm a lawyer, of course, it's understanding... it has been common sense understanding for a very, very long time. But what has been very unfortunate for the legal world, in other words, the world of lawyers in which I work, is that we have taken this issue to heart. And for the past year, we have been trying to raise our voices and try to get public discourse about this matter going in society. However, the media simply did not follow us and did not respond to our appeals to try to get their attention and to bring this to the attention of the people. However, things have changed tremendously since we were invited to speak in front of the Diet, in front of the Constitutional Research Committee. And since then, the media basically, until then, I think, was dead in regard to this matter. And they have revived and they have become invigorated and become very, very focused on this. And that has had a positive effect on the world of the lawyers, because we also have become resuscitated and are also very, very lively about this matter. In regard to people in very high positions in both the professional lawyers field and also in regard to the prosecutors, in regard to the judges, people in very high positions have privately spoken to me and said, you know, we have to do something about this. In other words, they share our similar concerns. This is common sense understanding among most people who understand this field. It is what has been missing is the understanding of the average person. And that, I think, is the because of the... dereliction of duty on the part of the media. They have not really focused on this idea until now. And the fact that so many of you are here today and hopefully will spread these ideas to the general public is something that fills me with great joy. Thank you.
ニコニコ動画の七尾と申します。よろしくお願いします。12日の記者会見でですね、民主党の岡田代表が、ちょっと先のことより申し訳ないんですが、法案成立後に最高裁がですね、違憲判決を出した場合について、岡田代表はですね、その時の内閣の対応は、総辞職に値すると発言されています。法の重さあるいは政治の責任ということにつきまして、最高裁でその違憲判決が出た時の政権というのはどう対応すべきだとお考えでしょうか。よろしくお願いします。
I'm from Nico Nico Doga. On the 12th, Mr. Okada, the president of the DPJ, gave a press conference, and he's apologizing for speaking about something that's in the future. But assuming that this legislation passes and that eventually a Supreme Court decision is given where this legislation is considered unconstitutional, he was asked what the administration should do in response. And his response was that the administration should take responsibility and resign in its entirety. When we consider the importance, the weight, the importance of law when we consider the responsibility of politicians, what do you think should be done by the administration if this is considered unconstitutional?
すみません、私はその岡田代表の会見を存じ上げてないので、正確なお答えになるかどうか分かりませんが、今仮に今年その法律が成立するとして最高裁が違憲の判断を出すのに相当時間がかかるわけですね。ですからその、仮に最高裁が違憲の判断を出したときにその時の政権が、どういう責任を負っているのかというと違憲の、法律であるのに、それをそのままメインテインしていたと、ということには、責任があると思いますが、それはその時の
内閣だけではなくて、そこまでの内閣はすべて責任があると、ということになるんだろうと思います。
はい、どうしてもそういう話になる、私もイライラするんですが、つまりね、違憲判決で4年かかるんですよ、大体ね。どうして4年間放っとくのか、その前になぜ作らせるのか、今、世論調査で支持率が下がれば、安倍内閣怖くなって、次の選挙怖いから辞めるんですよね。で、辞めないでやったら、それは露骨にひどいことをしたという印象で、次の選挙でやっぱり交代させなきゃ、だって次の参議院選挙で自民党が沈めば、憲法が改正できなくなるわけです。そしてその次の衆議院選挙で自民党政権を倒せばいいんですね。これが4年後の、およそ4年後の最高裁判決待つよりよっぽど早いですよ。
So first response was that I'm sorry I didn't hear from Mr. Okada's press conference. I don't know if my comments are going to be really in line with what he actually said. But even if assuming that this legislation passes this year and eventually a Supreme Court decision is handed out, then you see it, in regard to what the administration at that time should do in terms of taking responsibility, because they probably not be the same administration that actually passed the legislation, their responsibility it will be that they allowed such an unconstitutional legislation to stay on the books or stay in effect while they were in power. And this responsibility will also have a sort of retro effect in that all of the administrations until that point that allow that legislation to exist will also have to take some kind of responsibility. And Mr. Kobayashi is responding by saying, I often receive this question, and that question always makes me feel incredibly antsy or frustrated. The reason is that because if we wait for the court system to take care of this matter, then the Supreme Court decision will take 4 years to be realized. And my question is, why in the world would you allow such legislation to stay on the books for 4 years, and why don't take action early? In other words, if the results of different opinion polls show that the administration is losing its support, then Prime Minister Abe and his party will understand that if they don't decide to change tack, then they could suffer tremendously at the next election. If they understand that they might do badly in the next election, they might change course. If they still continue to pursue this next election, then first of all, then in the upcoming upper house elections, the LDP could suffer a tremendous defeat. That means that they would not have the numbers to be able to revise the constitution, which is, of course, Mr. Abe's goal. And then following on the next election, which are the lower house elections, if the LDP again is suffers tremendous losses, then you could basically perhaps overturn this legislation. My fundamental point is don't wait 4 years for a Supreme Court decision. There are many things people can do before that.
Thank you. I know there are more people who'd like to ask questions, but it's 2 o'clock, and it seems to me that this statements about responsibility and the popular will are a good place to wrap things up. So I want to thank everyone for coming, and I want to thank our two guests, Professor Hasebe and Professor Kobayashi. As usual, we have 1 year honorary memberships to the club, and I hope they come and visit us again. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, thanks very much.